Penguin Random House Audio presents The Hacking of the American Mind, The Science Behind the Corporate Takeover of Our Bodies and Brains. This is the author, Robert H. Lustig, MD, MSL. Introduction. Happiness is neither virtue nor pleasure nor this thing nor that, but simply growth. We are happy when we are growing. John Butler Yeats to his son William Butler Yeats, 1909. We were all children once. Like you, more chance than not, my greatest moments of happiness during childhood have stuck with me, and to this day continue to bring a smile and sometimes even a tear. Childhood is a time of mind expansion, not just in knowledge, but in experimentation, in inquisitiveness, in trying out new concepts and strategies. Childhood is supposed to be a time when the balloon of happiness soars high above the mundane. The tools of the trade for most kids were a peanut butter sandwich, a bicycle, and a bedtime story. I became a pediatrician in part to relive and help channel the wonder and delight involved in growth. Fast forward 4 decades. Children still grow, but sadly in my pediatric clinic, I now watch many of them grow horizontally rather than vertically. Some take medicines previously reserved for adults, like metformin for type 2 diabetes or benazepril for hypertension. And that balloon of happiness, that sheer wonder of it all, is now so deflated, there isn't enough buoyancy for it to soar. Rather, in its place has been dropped some weighty pleasures of the mundane, in this thing or that. Standard issue now are Capri Sun, Netflix, and Snapchat. You might argue, well, that's progress, that's convenience, that's technology, that's our new instant gratification culture. Buy a pleasure to increase happiness. But what if those pleasures, ostensibly developed and marketed in the name of increasing your happiness, actually did the opposite? What if they actually made you unhappy? What if they changed your brain so that happiness was sapped from you? What if today's kids are actually canaries in the coal mine? What if these same brain changes extended to your coworkers, to your friends, to your family members, and to you? For better or worse? And better for whom? Pleasure and happiness are similar, as they both feel good, but Yeats knew they weren't the same. Since the recording of time, philosophers have tried to wrestle these two positive emotions to ground. These two uniquely human phenomena have together and separately occupied outsized parcels of our consciousness, our literature, and our national and international discourse. While our philosophers and social commentators have spent the last 3,000 years defining and redefining these two terms for us, something quite unusual and likely even sinister has befallen these related yet decidedly different positive emotions. These past 40 years have witnessed the twin epidemics of the negative extremes of both of these emotions: addiction, from too much pleasure, and depression, from not enough happiness. Yet in these same 40 years, our knowledge of brain science has advanced to the point where these two emotions can now be dissected and parsed at a biochemical level. Did the uptick in prevalence of addiction and depression occur naturally, separately, in a vacuum, or under some form of outside pressure? What or who has ushered modern society into this new normal? What if all of Western society has been hacked to profit a few at the expense of the many? And what if you didn't even know you'd been hacked? Hack is a word with a relatively short history in our modern lexicon and with a fluid meaning. The first reference to a hack was at a meeting of the MIT, my alma mater, Model Railroad Club in 1955. At that time, hack meant a prank whose perpetrators demonstrated style, resourcefulness, and whimsy in its performance. Stealing a car is a felony offense. stealing a Boston Police Department vehicle, disassembling it, carrying each piece up 5 floors, and then reassembling it at the top of the Great Dome of MIT, complete with a life-size policeman mannequin and a box of donuts in the front seat. Now that's a hack. More recently, Silicon Valley types stole the word to denote clever solutions to difficult problems, known as white hat hacking. Yet black hat hacking dates back to 1963, when an unauthorized hacker remotely commandeered the MIT mainframe computer. As computers became more interconnected and more technologically advanced, less whimsical people started to create viruses to infect other computers, and hacking took on a much more ominous and sinister tone. As we all learned from the 2016 election debacle, today's computer hacking encompasses 3 steps. Step 1 is phishing, with a P, where a seemingly benign yet imperative email message with a disguised zip file or URL is sent to an unsuspecting victim. If the message is clicked, that computer is rendered vulnerable and the hacker can gain entry. Step 2 is the insertion of some form of malicious code into the victim's computer. Depending on the goals of the hacker, step 3 is the hijacking of something. For instance, the materials stored in the computer's memory, like Democratic National Committee emails, which is then transferred to the hacker, who can then use it to humiliate or blackmail, or the computer's executable files in order to hold the computer for ransom, or even the victim's hard drive, which can be crashed and erased, the ultimate in malevolence. You say, well, that's computers. What does this have to do with the human body or brain? How about everything? While human hacking does not occur via computer code, there are many ways to tinker with the human brain. Certainly drugs can do the tampering. How about cleverly disguised messages, disinformation, propaganda, and the newest method of tampering, fake news? Can these messages act like phishing? And what if one of these messages gains hold? Can these alter your brain? Or how about something as innocuous as food? All the above. In this book, I'm going to develop separate and parallel scientific, cultural, historical, economic, and social arguments that our minds have been hacked. I will also demonstrate that this hack, the systematic confusion and conflation of the concepts and definitions of pleasure and happiness, has been inserted into the limbic system, emotional part, of our brains, thereby precipitating a slow-motion crash of a substantial percentage, somewhere between 25 and 50% of individuals, and exacting a severe detrimental impact on our whole society. I will also demonstrate that this hack wasn't accidental, but in fact has been a plot. That is, the hack was not just to create mischief. Rather, it was specifically designed and engineered with a profit motive. And similar to the Russian hack of the 2016 presidential election, this plot has been and continues to be executed by private interests with governmental support. In order to convince the listener of each of these arguments, I will first lay out, in simple terms, the neuroscience of each of these 2 otherwise positive emotions, how they can sometimes appear similar, but more importantly, how they differ, what underlies our experience of each one, and how they influence each other. I will then explain how the business community and government have taken advantage of this neuroscience to hack our decision-making capacity and alter our level of individual and collective well-being. But fear not, even though this plot is pervasive in all walks of life, there are ways to insulate yourself and fend off this hack. Because when we understand the neuroscience of pleasure and happiness, and each one's relationship with the other, and how they are manipulated by our current food, technology, and media environments, we can more accurately denote the causes, and in turn the treatments, for our own personal well-being and for our twin societal scourges. I am not a psychiatrist or an addiction specialist. I am not a motivational speaker or a pop culture icon. I am not a Buddhist or a self-help guru. I am definitely not Dr. Oz or Dr. Phil, Nor do I want to be. Those guys have got their own problems. I am not a purveyor or user of psychoactive substances, although I've consulted with some experts for this book. I am not even a strict practitioner of all the precepts elaborated in this volume. And I certainly don't have a corner on either the pleasure or happiness markets. Hell, I got my own issues and baggage. I am a practicing pediatric endocrinologist, hormone problems in children, and obesity research scientist at UCSF.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.